Welcome to the Epilepsy Foundation's videos on epilepsy and cannabis. Cannabis, also known as cannabidiol, CBD, for treating epilepsy has been a topic of interest for a number of years. The Epilepsy Foundation developed this peer-to-peer education for healthcare providers about CBD and epilepsy to provide important factual information and dispel myths and misperceptions about this topic. Recently, a purified pharmaceutical form of CBD was tested, like other prescription medications, for two forms of severe epilepsy, Dravet syndrome and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. Both syndromes start in childhood and are associated with very difficult-to-control seizures, multiple seizure types, and other developmental problems that can progressively worsen. These videos were designed to share what we know, what we don't know about CBD and epilepsy, and includes published data on the first FDA-approved CBD product for treatment of Dravet and Lennox-Gastaut syndrome. The participants share their knowledge and experiences about what to consider about CBD in general and tips for counseling people with epilepsy and families. The project was funded in part by Greenwich Biosciences. The Epilepsy Foundation editorial board of epilepsy.com and staff had complete control on the creation and review of this content.
Hi, my name is Dr. Joe Servin. I'm editor-in-chief of epilepsy.com, and welcome to the Epilepsy Foundation's discussion on cannabidiol for epilepsy. I have two terrific colleagues who are going to be helping me navigate our understanding of the pharmacology of cannabidiol. I'm going to let them introduce themselves, but I'll start off with Anoop.
Hi, I'm Anoop Patel, Section Chief of Neurology at Nationwide Children's Hospital in Columbus, Ohio. I'm also the editor for the medical cannabis content on epilepsy.com.
Barry?
Hi, I'm Dr. Barry Goodell, University of Wisconsin-Madison. I'm a professor of pharmacy, and I'm also the co-editor of the medication section of epilepsy.com.
Question number one, what are the side effects of this drug? And maybe we can kind of ask you, Anoop, to kick us off with some of the most common ones that are listed, and I'll ask Barry to chime in as well.
Yeah, I think we've learned a lot with the studies that have been done looking at cannabidiol, or specifically the Epidiolex product. And what we've learned is that there are some side effects that have risen to the top as being more common. So for example, sedation mm-hmm. was one that was seen, so a little nausea, perhaps some diarrhea, GI upset. Those are the things that seem to have risen to the top. I think we're going to want to talk about, as far as the more severe or ones that you need to watch out for, is the elevated liver enzymes.
Sure.
And I think that's something that we learned that perhaps we're a little surprised about, perhaps not. Overall, though, I think one of the biggest themes I want to emphasize here is that just because this plant is from the ground is the concept of natural. And we have to have a great appreciation of chemicals found in any structure.
Right.
And that understanding is that they are important to know where they break down in your body or metabolized. In the case of medical cannabis or cannabis in general, many of those interactions are because of differences of metabolizing through the liver. And that's all based on a huge knowledge and understanding of the liver enzyme systems and how you metabolize drugs versus how the other person does, and those interactions can occur. We've learned a lot as it relates to cannabidiol and Epidiolex, but that doesn't mean this product has side effects that the other cannabidiol products, for example, in the vernacular form, don't have.
Yeah.
One of the things I hear is that, CBD has all these side effects. Well, that's why you need to take the dispensary form. No, it's just those haven't been studied, so they're not listed. And I think that's an important feature we should emphasize.
That is a great point.
At the doses that were demonstrated to have therapeutic activity and be efficacious of Epidiolex, at 10 and 20 milligrams per kilogram per day, we saw these interactions. When I've had people say, well, in some of the artisanal formulations, they never noticed any of these. Well, it may very well be, again, a dose effect. What were you really getting? What were the actual doses and what was systemically available to cause an interaction?
A lot of people often ask questions about can I study while I am on this? Can I work while I'm on this? In other words, the cognitive side effects and development side effects. Can you kind of maybe elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, I think that it really goes back to our original conversation on the fact that CBD or cannabidiol does not bind to those CB1 and CB2 receptors. You don't experience the euphoria. But then as far as cognition, we don't think there should be negative events from that. Of course, if you're on other medicines and there is sedation, as is the case with clobazam and Epidiolex, then perhaps that's going to affect your ability to learn or have cognitive issues. But one of the things that we saw, at least in our experiences throughout the study, was that kids tended to have either improved or neutral relations as it was for their cognition. But many kids decided, or parents said, I'd like to stay in the study because those cognitive benefits are so great. Even though my seizure control isn't optimal, I'm still happy with the cognitive issue. So we do not feel the cognitive, potential cognitive benefits, because it does need further study, is directly or all related, more importantly, to the effect on seizure control. We do feel there might be a benefit beyond that relation to cognition and improvement in that regard. But again, more studies need to be done to further, you know, elucidate that potential finding.
Most folks always ask, is this something I swallow, smoke, inhale, or take any other way?
The prescription form, the form that's been FDA approved, will come as a solution, so it should be swallowed. It should not be administered through any other route.
How does levels play a role, if any, in the management of this particular drug?
We don't have the data. The studies were not really designed to construct concentration effect curves, if you will.
Anything that people need to know about in terms of just the management when one initiates or keeps these medications going?
I think because we saw elevations in the liver enzymes, that's one to pay special attention to, specifically if the patients are on concomitant valproic acid. I know personally that does raise that flag with me.
Sure.
I think that's going to be something that you'd have to watch out for.
So do you have to check also any other labs, electrolytes or blood counts or anything like that, like you do with some other medication?
You know, we really didn't see too many fluctuations in that regard, which was really nice to be able to see. You know, we didn't see fluctuations in sodium levels or potassium or other electrolytes that have been commonly recommended to be checked. So in that sense, I don't think that's necessary.
What would be the way, at least, that it'll likely be dosed at the beginning?
Start low and go slow.
Yes.
Which I find to be really amazing that we're kind of adopting a milligram per kilogram dosing structure for this medicine. We in the pediatric epilepsy space are obviously very used to that, but that's obviously what's going to also be recommended in the adult space. So very different for our adult colleagues for dosing. You know, one of the things we're going to recommend is that they start at a low dose, perhaps 5 milligram per kilogram per day, and then kind of slowly titrate. We feel that the dosing that was used in the study, it's either 10 or 20, is obviously where the labeling will come into play. But as all of us do, we will have to figure out what works for our patients, either obtaining seizure control and not having adverse events or side effects. There's not going to be an overall structure of who should you go higher on and who should you not. That's going to be where the art of medicine that we all practice comes into place, and we do it on a regular basis.
Can you give a sense of what is kind of the typical dosing in terms of per day that one is likely to use as we start utilizing the drugs in an adult patient, perhaps?
So if you look at an average, or it's not the average, the actual bottle of Epidiolex, it's 100 milligrams of medicine in per ml. So each milliliter of the medicine will have 100 milligrams of it. So if you say an average person is 70 kilograms,
sure,
right? That means if you're dosing them at 10 milligram per kilogram per day, well, then they're going to need 700 milligrams per day. And that's going to then translate to their dosing. So you can expect it anywhere from low weight kids, something as small as 1 to 2 milliliters twice a day, all the way up potentially to 10, even higher. You know, for people who are overweight or obese, for example, they're still going to actually do dosing per weight. So there's not a recommendation for a top out dose. Right. It's going to be just based on how much they weigh.
will we need to be very cautious, and this comes up so often in hospital-based environments, people who have liver disease, kidney disease, will we have to adjust for those as a result of the way this is processed?
Yeah, because it is extensively metabolized through the liver, through all these other enzyme systems we're talking about. There is actually guidance in the package insert for very mild liver dysfunction. Don't really need to modify the dose terribly much, but for moderate to more severe, yes, there's going to be guidance in the insert to cut down. So yes, we will need to pay attention to that. Kidney disease, not so much. You know, another practical thing, the Epidiolex solution is going to be coming with a dosing syringe, a measuring device. And this is what should be done for all medicines, but far too often I see people that, you know, they lose them. Instead of going and getting a replacement, they pull out a teaspoon or a dessert spoon or a tablespoon.
Sure, sure.
And for this medicine, I want to discourage that. That's a very inaccurate way.
Yeah, precise measurements obviously is something that we have to really pay attention to in pediatric epilepsy, and now we're going to ask our adult colleagues to do the same, and I think that's an important point. The other thing is the more volume of oil you're taking into your body, that potentially might lead to things like diarrhea or whatnot.
Sure. I know we heard about if people go and get employment testing for while they're on Epidiolex, a lot of issues and concerns about whether they will test positive. Can you kind of elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, I think one of the most important things is if you're not taking Epidiolex, so you're doing a vernacular product in one of the dispensaries, you might test positive for THC in your urine drug test at work. And the reason behind that is we don't know how much THC is in these vernacular products. So if you do happen to get a product that has a high level of THC, you may not know it has that in it, but you will then test positive. So I think it's important for people to understand that it all depends on what you're taking and actually what's actually in it.
To that point, you know, with the pharmaceutical preparation with Epidiolex, I mean, the amount of THC was vanishingly small. And in the clinical trials, and even in studies using fairly high doses, it was, you know, below detection levels. So I think you're right. It's, again, know what product you're taking.
Anoop, I want to thank you so much for joining us today, and Barry, the same. Both of you have provided us with a treasure trove of very practical information that's going to be a huge benefit to myself and to all of our viewers out there. And I want to thank you all, the viewer, for joining us today. This has been Epilepsy Foundation's discussion on cannabidiol for epilepsy. My name is Dr. Joe Servin. I am editor-in-chief of epilepsy.com.